It's time now for the complete story with Dick Bott, a public news and information feature of Bott Radio Network, to keep you informed about the most important issues of our day. Now, here is Dick Bott with today's complete story.
Well, those of you who are listening across the network over the weekend, and you'll remember that in the state of Kansas, there were two grand juries that were being convened. One in the western side of the state, or southwestern, I guess it would be, in Wichita, Sedgwick County. And then another grand jury that had been petitioned, and apparently all of the dots had been in place and the T's crossed and everything like that for a grand jury there in the Johnson County, Kansas area. That's on the eastern edge of the state. So in those two cases, through a petition drive, the people had followed the law carefully and had obeyed all of the rules and everything else in order to convene a grand jury. Well, as it turns out now, just in the last few days, why, the Kansas Supreme Court has put a stay on the grand jury being convened. I guess it's supposed to go to work this week. And they've said, no, well, we'll just put a stay on that. We'll just put a stop order on that, as it were, and we have something else in mind. So what we have today, folks, so you can follow this, you know, this is an issue of a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And when the system works, it works quite beautifully. Sometimes it can be very, very frustrating. Sometimes it just seems as though it gets clogged up and doesn't want to work at all. But there are mechanisms for the people to have their voice heard. And the grand jury system, I'm learning a lot about it and just kind of watching this happen. The grand jury system is probably the opportunity for the people to speak. That would really kind of be the ultimate people's court. And now if that is subverted or delayed or interfered with, why, this is pretty serious as to the whole idea of a rule of law. So to kind of get to the bottom of this, we have two guests on today's complete story. One is Mr. Ben Hodge, and he's a Kansas representative, a legislator.
Hi, Dick.
From Overland Park, Kansas. And then Mr. Lance Kinzer, K-I-N-Z-E-R, and he's from Olathe, Kansas, and he's a lawyer as well as a representative. So it's good to have both of you gentlemen on the broadcast to kind of sort some of this out. Let's start with you, Representative Hodge. What on earth is happening?
Well, if I knew, I'd tell you. It comes down to the Supreme Court is they say that they are chosen by merit. They say that they are apolitical, that is to say impartial, not political, but our Supreme Court is in fact very political, and frankly no one knows what they're up to.
Apparently I was talking to someone who's somewhat of an expert, a specialist in the grand jury selection and the entire process, especially in the state of Kansas, and they said to me on the phone just less than an hour ago, there is no precedent for what has been done. Now, this only at this moment involves the grand jury that was to be put to work, convened and put to work in Wichita, Kansas. So George Tiller, the third trimester abortionist, why, his high-powered attorney, and he has several, they went judge shopping, as far as I can put the story together, and when they were turned down at the state court level and then the federal court and on and on and on, and then they finally ended up at the Kansas Supreme Court and said, essentially, we don't want a grand jury looking into our affairs. The things that have been charged against us, we do not want a grand jury to have a chance to look at the evidence. Representative Lance Kinzer, you're a lawyer as well as a legislator. How does that sound to you?
Well, Dick, first of all, thanks so much for having me on. And let me say that this is just another example of a series of extremely frustrating events dealing with the enforcement of late-term abortion law in the state of Kansas. And as some of your listeners may already know, we've been engaged in a battle, really, over a multi-year period, attempting to get those who are responsible for enforcing the law in the state of Kansas to move forward with appropriate enforcement actions against what I based upon what I think is very strong evidence that the laws of the state of Kansas on abortions, on viable unborn babies, are not being enforced. And really, the purpose of a citizen petition grand jury, as it's established in Kansas statute, and this is a law that's been in effect since the early 1970s, is, I think, perfectly situated for dealing with exactly a circumstance like this. That is, a circumstance where citizens have a very legitimate concern that the laws of the state of Kansas are not being enforced. And this is an opportunity for them to, in a sense, go around the good old boy network that oftentimes exists within, or at least can exist within the judiciary, within the law enforcement community, and require that a serious investigation of allegations of legal wrongdoing take place. And you're exactly right. As far as I know, and I'm not aware maybe of every single instance where a grand jury has been called, but the legal arguments that are being made, and I've had a chance to look at the brief that George Tiller and his attorneys filed, I think the legal arguments that are made are pretty novel here. I certainly haven't seen them raised in other grand jury proceedings that have occurred in the state of Kansas. And it goes to something I was talking to a judge, actually, who I'll leave unnamed, who made mention of the fact that there seem to be three kinds of law in Kansas. There's criminal procedure, there's civil procedure, and then there's abortion law procedure. And it really does seem as if judges and law enforcement in the state of Kansas, those who are charged with maintaining the law, executive branch agencies like the Kansas Department of Health and Environment, the Board of Healing Arts, the Attorney General's office under the current Attorney General, are treating abortion law and enforcement of laws related to abortion in a way completely foreign to the way that the normal legal process would work. And I just believe that a lot of that is driven not by respect for the rule of law, but by ideology.
See, or special interest, to say the very least, bought and paid for, is the allegation by many people. You see, treated the abortion laws is kind of a set aside, not to be touched, heavily protected, as though it's outside of public policy
right.
or legislative activity or anything else. Now, let me just read here a moment. An excerpt from the appropriate statute here. It's pretty short. It's Kansas Statute 22-3001. And I quote, "The judge or judges of the district court of the county shall then consider the petition, and if it is found that the petition is in proper form and bears the signatures of the required number of electors, a grand jury shall be ordered to be summoned." It doesn't say may be ordered. It doesn't say they'll think about it, or maybe the court will rule whether it's right or wrong. It simply says it shall be ordered when those conditions have been met. Now, does this not appear, gentlemen, you're both legislators, that the Supreme Court has overstepped its bounds of dipping into things that you should be concerned with? You have made the law. There's nothing in the Kansas Constitution, frankly, that permits them to do this. And unless there's something here I don't understand, are they not now making the law, pure and simple, the way they want it to be?
Well, yes, I would say that is the case. And if I think we often forget in this country that the judicial branch is not the is a separate branch, but it is not the supreme branch. Just because it says Supreme Court doesn't mean it's the supreme branch. We should have respect for that branch of government, but it is therefore equal to the legislative branch. And
yeah.
Dick, I'll just tell you quickly, what I'm concerned of is not that I don't expect that money is changing hands at this point. I think most of the money would have been in the races of 2002 and 2006. But I am concerned about is that there are reputations that on various levels, whether it's the Wichita District Attorney, whether it's the judges down there, whether it's Governor Sebelius, Attorney General Morrison, state Supreme Court justices, there are a lot of reputations that are on the line here. And my concern is, going back to what I said earlier, that the state Supreme Court is going to – my concern is that they are going – the seven judges are going to do as much as they can get away with without just getting away with as much as they can without going what they perceive as overboard, tipping the scale on frustrating Kansas citizens
yeah.
in protecting – all of these pro-choicers. I'll tell you, while I'm very pro-life, I respect people who are pro-choice, but they should not be pro-choice. The judiciary branch and the prosecutor should not be pro-choice in prosecuting laws.
Well, you see, that's the point, because I think we've stepped outside of the issue of abortion right now. Whether a person is pro-life or whether a person is pro-choice is no longer now the simple issue. What it is are we a government of the people, by the people, for the people, and do we go by the rule of law? Yes. And, of course, that is always tested in the judicial system. That's always tested in the court system. Now what you have is a specific law that has been on the books for many years, has never been questioned before. There is no precedent for what has happened. And finally, it works its way to the Supreme Court. By the way, the evidence presented in the case of this has been, I guess, looked at by two Kansas state judges, and they've said there's credible evidence that absolutely this should go to court, this should be looked into. There is clear evidence that something is happening outside the law, but nothing has moved. Now, I guess that's what the frustrating thing is to the Kansas people, and frankly, to all Americans listening to this broadcast, when you have officials that have either been appointed or elected, and they seem to be blind and deaf to the petition of citizens as to breaking the law, why then the grand jury process is exactly what is in place to help them, protect them, to make sure that things are the way they are. So let's just start at the governor's mansion. Kathleen Sebelius, she has a very, very long history of receiving money from the abortion industry, specifically George Tiller through his political PACs, and that's her record all the way back to when she was a representative. There's just no doubt about that. And then you look at the current Attorney General, Paul Morrison. Why, he made it very clear when he ran for office with a huge, huge amount of money, millions of dollars actually, that was given to him for television advertising, newspaper advertising, massive direct mail. Well, he made a promise that he certainly wasn't going to be concerned about the abortion issue if he was elected. So he just had a tremendous windfall of cash coming his way. Now, you can look at also some of the legislators, gentlemen, your colleagues, who are very known to be very strongly pro-abortion. I saw that some now are saying, well, this grand jury provision, why, this needs to be tightened. We need to change the law. There should not be an opportunity for people this easily to trigger it and have a grand jury assembled. So it just seems to me like the whole process now is in terrible turmoil if the Kansas Supreme Court goes outside the provisions of law in order to protect, because they themselves, of course, are they appointed by the governor or nominated by the governor? I mean, the process kind of is an old boy network thing, isn't it?
Yeah, well, Dick, one of the things, and this is Lance again, first of all, I really appreciate you couching this in the context of a real rule of law issue, because quite frankly, the recent action by the Supreme Court just kind of puts an exclamation point on what's been going on in the state of Kansas for some time now with respect to the absolute refusal by those who are in positions of authority to enforce the late-term abortion law in the state of Kansas. And I think that the argument that's been made in you, by the other side, and you articulated it accurately, that somehow this process of citizen petition grand juries, which has been in place for over 30 years in the state of Kansas, can result in witch hunts or bringing charges without evidence, I think bespeaks a real elitism within the legal community, that this belief that somehow, and I can tell you this as an attorney, that being an attorney doesn't bestow upon someone any special moral or intellectual power. The reality is that the purpose of the grand jury statute and the way that it's authored is specifically to say that the check against it being abused is the fact that you have to go out and get thousands of citizens to sign these petitions to say, we would like the grand jury to conduct an investigation. And that's all a grand jury does. It conducts an investigation, and then makes a determination as to whether there's sufficient evidence to move forward with charges. But the point I want to stress is that I think that those who argue that somehow this process is subject to real abuse fail to take into consideration that the good judgment of thousands of citizens within a county is required before one of these grand juries that can take place. And then just to move on to your point about the way the court is selected.
Well,
I think
let me say, and then it would take another level of judges before to approve anyone going to jail after that. I mean, so if they need to have faith in their own members to look at the evidence brought forth by the grand jury.
Yeah, let me just comment, Dick, on this Lance again, on the point you made about the way the court is selected. And our court, and Ben made reference to this at the outset, is selected by what is called a merit selection system. The problem is that we have a system that essentially allows attorneys in the state of Kansas to have, I think, an inordinate amount of influence over the selection of our appellate court judges. In fact, it's my understanding in looking at some recent research that we, in fact, have the only state in the country where the Bar Association of a state actually selects the licensed attorneys in the state select a majority of the nominating commission for Supreme Court justices. That nominating commission then presents a slate of three judges to the governor, who then has to pick one of those. And my belief is that system almost guarantees that you're going to get a certain type of person nominated, and it's typically not going to be someone who is sensitive to the things that we as conservatives would be concerned about.
Yeah, and you know, you see what you've said now is that out of the slate of nominees that are drawn up by the licensed attorneys within the state, then the governor, then she looks over that list and she picks out from that list names and that she then wants to submit. Well, it would be ludicrous to assume that she would not want judges that she then is going to select that would not see things her way. Now, that's very, very unfortunate, however. I heard Federal Judge Charles Pickering, I think he was from the U.S. Appeals Court, but he said, you know, folks, if we don't get back to whatever the Constitution says, whether it's the federal Constitution or the state constitutions, and absolutely stay a people that are ruled by the law as it is constitutionally, why, we will all be in a big mess, because while we as conservatives say, well, we want justices that see things our way, well, he said other people are just as sincere and they disagree with us and we don't think they're right at all, but they want then to have judges see things their way. And he said that is exactly why the law is what a justice system has to go by. And the legislators create the law, and then the judicial system compares it with the Constitution that the people have agreed that the state will adhere to. And none of those branches of government have to go outside of the bounds of their authority. Is that not essentially the way it is?
Well, Dick, this is Ben Hodge again. I want to elaborate on something Lance Kinzer said, if I can, and that is, even if we had a very good governor, whether Republican or Democrat, that was, you know, pro-life and that nominated judges who strictly interpreted the law, because of the way we nominate judges, that governor very likely would have a very poor slate to choose from. I'll just give two examples that come to mind. The American Bar Association, if you remember back in the last 4 or 5 years, there was a U.S. Supreme Court decision decided, fortunately on the good side, 5-4, but it was a very close 5-4 decision that allowed the Boy Scouts to choose what type of scoutmasters, whether they would be forced to have homosexual scoutmasters. The American Bar Association was on the wrong side of that. They filed a friend of the court to say, no, don't, you know, we want to force the Boy Scouts to choose the type of scoutmasters we want them to choose. And there was also a law just recently, it's either working its way through the federal Congress or maybe it just passed, that would allow anonymity in a citizen's right, a U.S. citizen's right, to report suspicious activity that might be terrorist related, and would allow them to not would prohibit them from being sued if they in you know they can say in good conscience, this looks suspicious. It may not be, but it looks suspicious, and I'm going to protect other people. Mm-hmm. Well, the trial lawyers oppose that because they want to let people sue and say, you're just choosing me because of the color of my skin or whatever, and that might happen 1 out of 1,000 times. But and those are just two examples that come to mind of where lawyers are on the wrong side of things when it comes to our laws. And they have a huge impact on the eventual – no matter what type of governor we have, they have a huge impact on the type of judges that are selected.
I want to read something that William Penn said, and it has never applied more directly than it is right now in this situation. William Penn was quoted as saying, governments, like clocks, go from the motion men give them. Wherefore, governments rather depend upon men than men upon governments. He said, let men be good, and the government cannot be bad. But if men be bad, the government will never be good. I know that some say, he went on to say, he said, I know that some say, let us have good laws, and no matter for the men that execute them. But let them consider that though good laws do well, good men do better, for good laws may lack good men, but good men will never lack good laws, nor allow bad ones. Now, it appears to me that the Kansas legislature has something on their plate that they're going to have to deal with. Are they going to protect their right in the process to make the law, create the law, and then the Supreme Court of the state of Kansas to simply uphold that law or find that it's constitutionally flawed, which in this case no one has suggested that is the way it is at all?
Well, Dick, this is Lance again, and I appreciate your comment. And you know, the one thing I will say, and we can all a matter for us to all keep in prayer, quite frankly, is that there will be a hearing, as I understand it, on November 16th, where the Supreme Court will hear argument in preparation for making a final decision on allowing this grand jury to go forward or not. And certainly, I'm hopeful that despite the action that the court has taken at this point, that they will ultimately do the right thing. But that having been said, your point about whether or not the Kansas legislature will finally take action to protect legitimate legislative prerogatives is a crucial one, because setting aside for the moment even this particular case, the instances of this Supreme Court acting in a way that from my perspective is activist and is contrary to the express will of the legislature under circumstances where it was inappropriate for the Supreme Court to act are really mounting. We can go back to December of 2004 in the case of State v. Marsh, where our state Supreme Court struck down Kansas's death penalty law, and it took Attorney General Klein at the time going to the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn our Kansas Supreme Court and get that overturned. And, you know, even Justice McFarland of the Kansas Supreme Court recognized that case for what it was and said that this decision was driven not by law but by the policy preferences of four new justices. And then we have the school finance case, State v. Montoy, where the Kansas Supreme Court ordered the legislative branch to make an appropriation of funds for K-12 education. And again, setting aside the issue of whether we should be spending more on education or less on education, the fundamental issue is, does the judicial branch have a right to control appropriations? And I think that goes to the very core of whether we're we have a democratic form of government or whether we're essentially an oligarchy where a limited number of judges selected through a non-democratic process have the power of the purse. And unfortunately, I was in the legislature at that time, there were some of us who were very desirous of standing up to the court on that issue, but ultimately we capitulated. And then on the heels of that, there was the case of State v. Lyman, which was a case where the Kansas Supreme Court, and I'm not putting this too starkly when I say this, essentially said that moral disapproval of the particular activity of a group is not a legitimate government interest. And this had to do with a Kansas law that imposed penalties in this particular case on a person who had sexually abused a child. And because that abuse involved a same-sex situation. The court struck down the penalty that had been imposed and did so in a way that was really striking. And now we see in the area of abortion jurisprudence at least a signal, although not a final ruling, from the Kansas Supreme Court that, again, they may be willing to disregard the clearly expressed will of the people as set forth in statutes cast by the Kansas legislature to pursue a policy preference. And so the point of all that is simply to say that this is not an isolated instance. I'm hopeful, prayerfully hopeful, that the Kansas Supreme Court will see that the statute that you read, Dick, and you read correctly, 223001, is very clear as to what the role of the judges are in determining whether a citizen petition grand jury is appropriate or not. They'll recognize that, in fact, the statute has been complied with, and they'll allow this grand jury to go forward. However, I have to say, given some of the cases that I've recited and the activism that's occurred in those instances, I'm concerned. But I'm still hopeful that when we get to November 16th, that the right will prevail and that we'll see this grand jury move forward.
Now, for clarification, there are two grand juries that we're talking about, and one is in Wichita, Sedgwick
right.
County, and this is the one that the Supreme Court, Kansas Supreme Court, has intervened. And they have remanded that to a two-judge panel now to consider it, look at it, mull it over, and on and on and on. Isn't that where that stands?
Well, what they've done is they've issued an order that came out last Friday, essentially staying, or as you said, putting a stop order on the proceedings of that grand jury. And then they've indicated that the judges who are responsible for moving forward with that grand jury essentially file an answer with the Supreme Court on or before November 16th of 2007, indicating essentially why the grand jury should go forward. I suppose if I was them, I would say the grand jury should go forward because we have a statute, 223001, that says how these things happen. It's been complied with, and that's the end of the story. But
and it's the people's. It's the people's wish.
That's
well,
right.
I want to thank both of you gentlemen. It's something now that the people, you know, I have said over and over and over again, and it's true that the people of Kansas, the citizens of Kansas, these are the job holders, these are the voters, these are the citizens, these are those who are holding their marriages together, raising their children, showing up for work, producing the food, for goodness sakes, for a good part of the nation. Kansas people are just as good as gold, frankly. But on the other hand, when you get a political power structure that is bought and paid for, and believe me, many, many people look on the record and say that's the way it is as pertains to the abortion industry. And so this is quite a moment in time. Well, our guest now on this chapter of the complete story, and we'll stay on this story, is Mr. Ben Hodge. He's a Kansas representative from Overland Park, Kansas. And then Lance Kinzer is also a representative in the legislature, and he's also a lawyer. Well, gentlemen, we'll watch this and see how it all works out. Now, Abraham Lincoln said this, because I know some people get weary. Abraham Lincoln said this, "I do the very best I know how, the very best I can, and I mean to keep on doing so until the end." We just don't give up, do we, gentlemen?
Well, that's right, Dick, and I appreciate you taking the time to let your listeners know a little bit more about this. And again, I think it's so crucial that we have a system in the state of Kansas that respects the rule of law, and that's fundamentally what the debate that we're having in Kansas on these issues have become right now.
Thank you, sir, and we'll thank both of you, gentlemen. This is Dick Bott. Now, we're out of time, and this chapter of The Complete Story is as a public service, and I'll see you later.